In the disjointness problem, we want to determine for two bit strings x and y whether the bitwise AND combination of those bit strings is equal to 0 or not. Put differently, we call x and y disjoint if there is no position in those bit strings such that both of the bit strings contain a 1 in that position. For example, if we have the bit strings 0110 and 0001, then those two bit strings are disjoint because the first position, both of them contain a 0. The second position, the first one has a 1, but the second one doesn't. The same is true for the third position. And in the fourth position, the first one has a 0 and the second one has a 1. So there's no position where both of them have a 1. But on the other hand, the bit strings 0110 and 0011 are not disjoint because in the third position, both of them contain a 1. And the bit strings 0110 and 0100 are also not disjoint because in the second position, both of them contain a 1. The name disjointness comes from the idea that a bit string of length n can encode a subset of a set of n elements. So for example, if I have a set of size 3, which say contains the numbers 1, 2, and 3, then a bit string of length 3 can encode a subset of that set. So the bit string 0, 1, 1 would, for example, encode the subset that contains the second and the third element, but not the first. So it would be the subset 2 and 3. A 0 here corresponds to not including an element in the subset, and a 1 says we should include an element in the subset. So now the disjointness function simply asks whether the two subsets encoded by the two bit strings x and y are disjoint. We would like to determine what the communication complexity of this disjointness function is. And our thinking about protocol trees and monochromatic combinatorial rectangles is really helpful here. We ask ourselves how many monochromatic combinatorial rectangles we need to partition the matrix that corresponds to this disjointness function. Consider the two inputs, x and the complement of x, and y and the complement of y, for some x that is not equal to y. Here, the complement of a bit string is exactly what you would think it is. If you have a bit string 101, the complement of it would be 010. So we just flip every bit in the bit string. Now, suppose we have a combinatorial rectangle that contains both of those inputs, so it contains x and the complement of x and y and the complement of y. Then that combinatorial rectangle, of course, must also contain x and the complement of y and y and the complement of x. This is just because of the properties of combinatorial rectangles, otherwise it's not a rectangle. But we know that the disjointness function for x and the complement of x is 1. X and the complement of x are, of course, disjoint because they cannot have a 1 in the same position. And the same is true for y and the complement of y. But if you look closely, you will realize that either x and the complement of y or y and the complement of x must actually be not disjoint. So the function value here for one of those two, or for both, must be equal to 0. And hence, the rectangle we've been looking at is not monochromatic, because it contains all of those elements, and some of them are equal to 1, and others are equal to 0, so they're not all the same. We conclude that every input of the form x and complement of x must be in a different combinatorial rectangle. There cannot be two such inputs that are contained in the same monochromatic combinatorial rectangles, so there must be in different ones. How many such inputs do we have? That's just counting how many bit strings of length n are there, right? So those are the possible values for x. And we have n bits, and there are 2 to the n many bit strings of length n. And therefore, we have 2 to the n many monochromatic combinatorial rectangles, at least. In fact, we know that we have more combinatorial rectangles than this that are monochromatic, because so far we've only accounted for monochromatic combinatorial rectangles where all the entries are 1. But some values in the matrix are 0, so there must be an additional monochromatic combinatorial rectangle capturing those zeros. So in total, we must have at least 2 to the n plus 1 monochromatic combinatorial rectangles that partition our matrix. And that means C of the disjointness function is at least 2 to the n plus 1. So there must be at least 2 to the n plus 1 leaves in a correct protocol tree for this function. And then we know that the communication complexity of this disjointness function is at least the log of that. So it's at least log of 2 to the n plus 1. And because we cannot exchange fractional bits, the communication complexity needs to be a whole number, so we have to round this up. So we know that the communication complexity of the disjointness function is at least n plus 1. And of course, we can also achieve n plus 1 with our naive trivial solution, where Alice sends her entire input to Bob, Bob does the computation, and then sends the result back to Alice. The communication complexity of the disjointness function is equal to n plus 1. As you can see, once we think about monochromatic combinatorial rectangles, it's quite easy to derive these type of results.